Welcome to this My Fest convocation. We are here to celebrate a major portion of our tradition, our roots in Norway, and those who immigrated to the United States from there and who brought with them a great respect for a number of things that we value. Not the least of them is music and the music of that wonderful country. Today we shall hear from Finn Benestad and our own Bill Halvorsen concerning the letters of Edvard Grieg. And they are fascinating things indeed. And they were written to people of remarkable importance in the life and times of Edvard Grieg. Tchaikovsky, I think, was a recipient, Brahms, and any number of others. Tomorrow at 11 o'clock, by the way, the MyFest celebration continues with a lecture from Dag Skjeldrup Ebba, who came here a year ago and confirmed the remarkable range of a collection of Scandinavian compositions that Augsburg College holds, a collection that for the time span it covers is probably the most remarkable in the world. Dag will discuss that collection tomorrow at 11 o'clock. We are pressed for time here. Finn Benestad will walk out of this room when he finishes his remarks at 11 o'clock. But luckily he has signed a book that he and Bill have worked upon. And so his signature will be available to you for purchase somewhere at the door, I suppose just beyond the commercial reach of the chapel, just outside the line. We are very grateful indeed that both Bill and Finn have been able to come and give us this presentation. We are grateful to the Scandinavian Foundation for underwriting a portion of it. And we are grateful to God for this gathering, and let us pray. Our Father who art in heaven, we thank thee for the bright light that has been shined upon this college by its beginnings. We pray for the continued capacity to celebrate our roots and to give thee praise through that celebration. We are grateful for music. We pray that it will help us understand thy will and bring us closer to thy spirit. We thank thee for this college, for all that it represents, both in respect to its tradition and all that it hopes for in respect to its future. We pray that what it hopes for is what you would have us dream of. In Jesus' name, amen. Welcome, Bill and Finn.
Thank you, President Frame. It's always a thrill to come back to this campus where I spent such memorable years both as a student and as a teacher more years ago than I care to remember. I see many familiar faces in the audience this morning, and it would be tempting to reminisce, but as President Frame indicated, we are limited for time, so I will forego that pleasure. However, I do want to recognize two people without whose influence I pretty clearly would not be here today. One of them is my former teacher and current good friend, Leland Saterin, in whose it was in Lee's class in music appreciation when in my first semester at Augsburg that I was introduced to serious music. And I still remember a lot of details of that class. Lee, I'll still take the final anytime you want to give it to me. I also want to recognize the importance of my dear friend Dag Skjeldrup Ebbe, who is sitting right next to Lee. Dag has been really my mentor as a translator. If any of you who have done translating know that in the process of doing translation, you learn an awful lot of the language. Dag has been there to help me over many rough spots through the years. We've worked on numerous projects. Delighted that Dag can be with us for this weekend, and I, for one, look forward to what I know is going to be a very exciting lecture tomorrow. So I hope that you will all come back for that. However, we must get on to Grieg. Professor Benestad and I are at the end. This is the grand finale of a four-week speaking tour in which we have been engaged that started at the Library of Congress nearly 4 weeks ago. And we are talking about our book, Edvard Grieg, Letters to Colleagues and Friends. We're going to make a two-part presentation, since there are two of us. I want to tell you a little bit about the process by which we got to the publication of this book, because I think it's a quite interesting story. And Professor Benestad will then take you into the pages of the book itself, and will give you some idea of what it contains. If I were to ask you, how many letters have you written in your life and where are they today? You obviously could not answer either question. Well, 35 years ago, which isn't so long ago, it's about the time that I left Augsburg College to go to Ohio State. At that point in time, nobody knew how many letters written by Grieg were still in existence or where they were. What happened was that in the mid-1960s, I almost made that mistake, in the mid-1960s, a group of scholars from Norway and Denmark got together to plan a definitive edition of the complete musical works of Edvard Grieg. And in the process of doing that, they began to collect from all over the world all kinds of materials relating to the life and work of Grieg. They wrote, among other things, to libraries in Europe and America asking, do you have in your files any letters of Edvard Grieg? If so, please send us a copy. And the copies began to come in. And in time, they had a collection of over 3,000 letters of Edvard Grieg. So the first step then in creating this book was taken long before I had any thought of the project, in the acquisition of copies of the original letters. The next step in the process was a very difficult one, and that was to transcribe, which is to say, to decipher the letters. They were written in longhand, in most cases over 100 years ago. In many cases, the ink has faded by now. Moreover, Grieg was a very frugal man. He wrote on both sides of some rather porous paper, and he wrote with ink. So you know what happens. The ink from the backside seeps through and obscures what is on the front side of the letter. So very many of the letters are difficult to read, partly because the ink has seeped through. On the left side of what you're seeing, you see his signature in reverse down here. That's not because I have it on backwards, it's because you're looking at what is seeping through from the back side. Now that happens to be a page that was written only on one side, but over here on the right-hand side you see two sides, and what is seeping through from the back is obscuring what you're trying to read from the front. So my good friend Professor Benestad has spent, I'm sure, thousands and thousands of hours risking his eyesight with a magnifying glass in order to determine word by word what these 3,000 plus letters had to say. Moreover, a fair number of them were in German, as Grieg wrote two languages fluently, Norwegian and German. Most of his letters to non-Norwegian recipients were written in German. But it gets even worse. I told you that Grieg was a frugal man. In fact, he was absurdly frugal. When When Greg, frequently, when he got to the end of a letter and he hadn't finished saying what he had to say, rather than waste another piece of good paper that could be used for a letter to someone else, he simply wrote a second layer of text at a 90-degree angle over the first. So you now, not infrequently, have to deal not only with the front of the letter and the backside seeping through, but another layer of text printed over at a 90-degree angle. Needless to say, the task of deciphering those letters was a very, very enormous one. The next step in the process was to select the letters to be translated, and that is a task that Professor Benestad and I together, there's a third step, that was the publication of the letters in the original languages. That was done by Professor Benestad in 5 volumes, 3 in Norwegian and 2 in German. Then came the selection of letters to be translated, and that step was taken at the Center for Advanced Study of the Norwegian Academy of Science and Letters in Oslo. Professor Benestad and I spent 2 wonderful months together reading through these many letters and selecting those that we thought would be of greatest interest and importance for American and British readers. The criteria according to which we made our choice are stated here, and I'll not go through them in detail because I want to leave most of our time for Professor Benestad this morning, but they are summarized here. We were looking for letters dealing with historically important people and events, letters that shed light on Grieg's life, letters that illuminate Grieg's character, values, and innermost thoughts, letters providing information about the writing of one or more compositions, and other matters of general interest. The fifth step in the process was the translation of the letters, which has been my interesting occupation for about the last 2 years. Grieg writes beautiful Norwegian, and by and large, it's a joy to translate those letters. However, he did live in the 19th century, and I have learned that in the 19th century, the sentences were very, very long and very complex. Moreover, his years in Germany probably corrupted his Norwegian to some extent. There are letters in which I swear all the verbs are on the last page. However, by and large, the translation of these letters was straightforward, and I had an expert available via email for problems that I couldn't solve on my own. And in the end, we're confident that we have an accurate translation that hopefully reads as if Grieg had been writing in English. That's always the aim of the translator. Lastly, the letters that we selected and translated had to be filled out with introductions to the recipients, with footnotes explaining references that would not be readily understood by many readers. We added a couple of appendices, a chronological list of all the letters in the book, plus a complete list of Grieg's composition, and then indexes both to compositions and general index to names and topics. So the result, then, is this book, which consists of 503 letters to 110 recipients, and I think now you want to get some idea of what those letters say. So with that, let me call on my dear friend and very distinguished colleague, Finn Benestad.
President Frame, colleagues, students, ladies and gentlemen, now even dear family, I have 2 family members here. Won't you rise? Yes. So So I put you all together and say, dear music friends, I really feel privileged to stand here at the MyFest to talk about my favorite composer, Edvard Grieg. And his brilliant prose is on a par with any writings in music literature. And reading, writing down, editing, and translating this marvelous material has been a continuous labor of love, both for my eminent collaborator, William Halvorsen, and for me. Of course, I can only give you a few glimpses from our book today, so you will have to continue reading in your own books. I have chosen to talk about Grieg the man, that is, the man behind the music. I should like to begin on a personal note. I grew up during the Second World War in Kristiansand, on the southernmost part of Norway. And after the German troops had invaded our country in 1940, they confiscated our radios so that we would not be able to listen to Radio Free Norway, London. But the confiscation also had a side effect. Unless we were lucky enough to own a phonograph, you know, the old ones you had to wind up. Unless we owned such a phonograph, we were prevented from hearing any other music than we did ourselves. Unfortunately, our family did not have that kind of luxury. However, one of our neighbors was the proud owner of such a fabulous device. And on Sundays, he often took the phonograph out into the backyard and played for us children in the neighborhood. And I remembered it as if it were yesterday. He played Beniamino Gigli, Caruso, orchestral music. And on special days, particularly on the 17th of May, you know, the Norwegian Constitution Day, he came out with a special set of records which he handled with the utmost care, as if they were his most precious possession. And can you get what he played? No, I'm sure you cannot, but here it comes. Grieg's A minor piano concerto, his gateway to international fame, and in short, Grieg in a nutshell. And Grieg was justly proud of his concerto and often wrote about it in his letters. And one of many such occasions was in a letter to his parents in 1870, just 1 year after the first performance of the concerto. And in this letter, he tells about his meeting with Franz Liszt in Rome. And he says, present in addition to me were some other composers and some young women whose admiration for Liszt was comical. You have a caricature here. They competed with each other to get close to Liszt, touch the edge of his long robe, and finally to take his hand. Yes, later when he played, the women stood around the piano with their eyes stiffly glued to his fingers, as if the fingers were destined in the next moment to become a sacrifice to those greedy admirers. Yeah. And he continues, I was very eager to see if Liszt really would sight read my concerto. He brought it in manuscript to Liszt, you know. Something that I, as Grieg, for my part, considered an impossibility. Liszt, however, was of an entirely different opinion. He said, will you play, sir? I quickly said, no, I can't. But then Liszt took the manuscript, went to the piano, and said with a characteristic smile to all those present, well, then I'll show you that I can't either. But then he began, says Grieg, and in view of what he now achieved, I must say that it would be impossible to imagine anything of the kind that would be more sublime. It is typical that he played a cadenza, which is among the technically most difficult parts of the concerto. He played it just perfectly, and his gestures are priceless. You see, he doesn't just play. Now he carries on a brilliant conversation, not with one person, but with the entire audience, distributing significant nods to the right and to the left, mainly when he is particularly pleased with something. And in the adagio, the second movement, and to an even greater extent in the finale, he reached a peak in both execution and in the praise he gave. And the appearance, there is one perfectly divine episode that I should not forget. Towards the end of the finale movement, as you will remember, the second theme is repeated in a great fortissimo. And in the very last measures, where the first note of the first triplet of the theme, G sharp in A major, the leading note, is changed to G in the orchestra, while the piano in a tremendous scale passage traverses the entire keyboard, Liszt suddenly stopped, rose to his full height, left the piano, and with mighty theatrical steps and raised arms strode through the great monastery hall, literally roaring out the theme. It is this one. Da, ra, ra, da, 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 da. And the next time with a G. Da, ra, da, ra, ra, da, ra, ra, da. And when he got to the above mentioned G, says Grieg, Liszt gestured imperiously with his arm and cried, G, G, not G sharp. That sounds Swedish. Well, so much about Grieg's first meeting with Franz Liszt. The following year, he met another Franz. That was Franz Beyer of Bergen, Grieg's home city. Franz, who was to become his most intimate friend for the rest of his life. He studied law in Christiania, and Grieg and he were become friends just all of a sudden. Grieg had hundreds of acquaintances, many of whom he also regarded as friends, but the only one he trusted in all situations was Franz Beyer, and his letters to him rank among the most moving and profound in Norwegian culture. Never did Grieg unburden himself more candidly than he did to Beyer. Through the vicissitudes of life, in periods of prosperity and tribulation, at times self-denying in his relationship with others, at times exhibiting the typical egocentricity so often associated with artists in the Romantic era. And the two friends discussed politics, religion, local and international problems, the musical situation in their mutual home city, and Grieg reports many a time from his successes in Europe's concert halls. And not least, they found each other in grandiloquent eulogies of Norwegian nature. And we have included 50 letters from Grieg to Beyer in our book. And of special interest are some letters from 1883, which were written during a very critical period in Grieg's life. And Grieg writes to Franz Beyer, who tried to help Nina and Edvard during this time. "Your letters are like balm for my sick soul. You always write in a way that moves me deeply, dear, dear Franz. If only I could ever get you to feel the grateful joy at having a true friend that pervades my whole being when I read your letters. I think and think until I almost go crazy, but I won't even try to dig around in that anthill of feelings, moods, and impressions that make me feel that it is best for me to be where I am just now. If only, Franz, if only I knew that I would find Norway again someday." He had been away for half a year then. "And at the same time find joy in the thought of home, then of course all this traveling would be cause only for rejoicing. But for me, happiness is nowhere to be found unless I find it in myself." And in Grieg's life, there was a continuous inner struggle between turbulent storms and brilliant sunshine. In an 1886 letter to Franz Beyer from Copenhagen, the sunshine is prevalent. "Spring is spring and birdsong is birdsong. And friends are friends. And I have many of them here too in Copenhagen, but none of them understand as you do what is drawing me toward scenes of home. And for that reason, I also have the feeling that all the others down here more or less disappear into the fog for me at this time. How about a quiet afternoon in the boat or out between the skerries and cliffs at home? Franz, the other day I got so full of this longing for home that it took the form of a gentle tune of thanksgiving. There is nothing new in it, but it is genuine. And since in essence it is nothing but a letter to you, I will include it here. The colors are the soft hues of Western Norway, but the heart of the piece was beating for your old friend when I wrote them down." This is part of the letter, a whole composition written by Grieg. Can you read it here?
Yeah.
And why not hear it also? was printed in Lyric Pieces, Opus 43, as In My Native Country. And in the same letter to Bayer, Grieg also alludes to another piece in the same volume of Lyric Pieces, namely Little Bird. And Grieg writes, "It is sad to have property in the country and not be able to be home in early spring, for that is when one gets all one's ideas. And what about the birds' nests that I have almost forgotten? If only some of the small birds could come and take up residence amongst us." And now we'll let you hear that piece, Little Bird. And you probably won't believe it, but it is true. It is Grieg himself playing in a recording from 1906. Fascinating, isn't it? Grieg shared with Franz Bayer an intense love of Norwegian nature. They hiked together in the mountains of western Norway as often as they could. In the mountains, they met fiddlers and folk singers, and Bayer wrote down many folk tunes. Grieg did not. We know of only one folk tune written down by Grieg. And to give you a little glimpse of their joint experiences during such mountain trips, I quote from a letter to the Danish friend of Grieg's, Niels Raunkilde. He reads, "I must tell you about a wonderful sunny August day between the Skagastøl peaks. Franz Bayer and I were going to cross a mountain, but we couldn't get a mountain guide, partly because it was Sunday and partly because the men were out hunting reindeer. Then two nice milkmaids from a mountain farm appeared, one older and one younger. And the younger one, a gorgeous blonde, as Grieg, was named Susanna. These two offered to go with us over the mountain. So with singing and jollity, we started out, and up at the top we sat down and made the best of what the knapsacks could offer us. Cognac and glacier water helped elevate the mood to an absolutely ethereal height. But the most beautiful part was still to come. For Susanna had brought a little national instrument with her, a ram's horn, a goat's horn, on which you can play just three tones. And after the girls had said goodbye to us up there at the top, because they had to go down to milk the cows, Franz and I stood entranced by the beautiful sight as they walked along the edge of the mountain. The girls, fair, graceful, and erect, with a blue horizon as background. And all of a sudden, they stood still. Suzanne put the ram's horn to her mouth. I will never forget the pose, the outline of her body against the sky, And then, as if it were coming from the mountain scenery around us, we heard the soft, melancholy sound. Here is the letter. And says Grieg, when the final G had died away, we looked at each other, Franz and I, and stood there in tears, for we had both felt the same way. You see, Nils, this is the sort of thing that makes a Norwegian musician become bewitched. Away, away, home, home, are words that recur again and again in Grieg's letters. When he was home at his beautiful Trollhogen, he yearned for the musical life in the big concert hall on the continent. But as soon as spring was approaching, he felt Norway calling him back, and he suffered from a terrible homesickness. In a letter of October 87 from Karlsbad, Germany, he exclaimed, "Yes, Norway, Norway, let Ibsen say 100 times that it is best to belong to a big nation. I can perhaps agree with him from a practical point of view, but I will not go a step further, for ideally viewed, I would not belong to any other nation in the world." Since his years of study in Leipzig, Grieg had gone through life with only one lung, and his last years were marked by increasing illness. And in December 1906, he wrote to his friend Franz Beyer, "I think death is beginning to send out its calling card during these days. It is as if it wanted to say, I am not far away. You can expect me soon." And Grieg was right. Just a few months later, he died. But to paraphrase General Douglas MacArthur, old composers never die. They do not fade away. They are reborn again and again through the immortality of their music. And Grieg will live today, tomorrow, next week, next month, next year, for hundreds of years. He will live not only in his letters, but in the songs, the piano music, the choral music, the orchestral music, and especially, perhaps, in the piano concerto that we all know so well, the concerto that ends like this.